and a baby Gray's leg was injured. During the rest, Gray, who suffered from asthma, also asked for an inhaler but did not receive one. Following his arrest, police placed him still handcuffed into the back of a police van. They did not place him in a seatbelt, although that was required by department regulations. The van then made four stops. During the first stop, police took Ray out and they placed him in leg restraints and they put him back in the van, but once again, they did not secure his body. When the van arrived, finally at the police station, after taking three more stops, officers found Ray to be unresponsive and not breathing. Police rushed Ray to the University of Maryland Stop Trauma Center. He underwent surgery and he died a week later with a spinal injury. Freddie Gray's death sparked protests in Baltimore that continued for several days. Baltimore's chief prosecutor, State Attorney Marilyn Mosby, announced that six Baltimore officers would face criminal charges ranging from second-degree assault to involuntary manslaughter in the death of Gray. Our goal in organizing today's panel is to provide some history and context for these events. Each panelist will speak for about 10 minutes so that we can allow time for questions. And before we start, I'd like to introduce our speakers. Our first speaker is Dr. Stacey Smith. She is an associate professor in the School of History, Philosophy, and Religion, and she specializes in the history of the North American West, slavery, and the U.S. Civil War and Reconstruction. She's also the author of Freedom's Frontier, California and the Struggle Over Unfree Labor, Emancipation, and Reconstruction, which won the prestigious 2014 David Montgomery Prize in Labor and Working Class History. I'd now like to hand things over to Dr. Stacey.
Right. Well, thanks so much for coming out today. As Professor Ritzheimer said, I'm actually the person whose research is perhaps least relevant and least contemporary, but what I'm going to be doing here today is as a historian of the 19th century slavery, race, and enslavement, but try to kind of get us to think about the broader, longer historical context for what's been happening in Baltimore, and really to think about the relationship between race, policing, and violence in U.S. history. Now, as my colleague Marisa Chappell will explain in just a moment, both police brutality and the protests in Baltimore originate in many historical trends that are actually coming out of the 20th century, later than the period that I study. So post-industrial decline and poverty, de jure and de facto residential segregation in urban areas, the war on drugs, and a rise of the carceral state, by which would be, of course, the prison industrial complex. But I'd actually argue today that many of these events have deep roots in the centuries-old history of slavery in the United States and the construction of a white supremacist social and legal regime built on the constant policing and surveilling of black people. Well, the policing of people of African descent, of course, stretches all the way back to colonial North America. The birth of a modern system of American policing happened at the same time as the massive expansion of slavery in the 19th century United States, and in many ways that is not a coincidence. We have, as a case in point, the city of Baltimore, the topic of our panel today. In 1853, the images are coming up pretty small here. In 1853, the city of Baltimore was among the first handful of 19th century U.S. cities, including New York and Boston, to develop a regularized modern police force to have some formal procedures, formal districts, uniforms, badges, what we think of as part of kind of modern policing. And in the slaveholding South, where whites were generally pretty suspicious of state power, Baltimore was second only to the city of New Orleans in creating this kind of modern police force. And according to some kind of dubious and contested sources, Baltimore may in fact have been the first city in the United States to equip its police force with handguns. City ordinance issued in 1856 authorized the distribution of Colt 49 pocket model pistols that you see pictured here to police officers in the city. These are actually New York City policemen, but I don't have Baltimore, so this is to give you kind of the sense of what this would have looked like. Now, to understand why Baltimore was an early adopter of kind of modern policing procedures and methods, we need to understand the city's place within the 19th century history of slavery. Maryland, where Baltimore is, was a border state on the boundary between slavery and freedom. The northernmost slave state between free Pennsylvania to the north and the very, actually the most populous slave state, Virginia, to the south. But most importantly, it's a state where slavery was on the decline for decades before the U.S. Civil War. The waning of tobacco cultivation in the upper south states of Maryland and Virginia prompted many slaveholders in these states to turn to wheat agriculture, which was actually more profitable with free labor than with slave labor. So hundreds of masters in these upper south states actually manumitted their slaves, which means they voluntarily freed them. Before actually the state started making that practice illegal for reasons that I'll explain in just a moment. Freed slaves in Maryland gathered in urban areas, particularly the city of Baltimore. By the time of the U.S. Civil War, Baltimore's free people of color made up 17% of the city's entire population. That means it had the largest free black population in the United States in the decade before the Civil War. This large population of free people of color, I think, is in part what's driving white Baltimoreans' demand for more formalized policing in Baltimore. It gives rise to that modern police force that we just talked about. While slavery was on the decline in Maryland and in the other parts of the Upper South, the same was not true for the rest of the slaveholding United States. Hopefully you can sort of see this as an overview here. While slavery, again, is on the decline in the Upper South, the explosion of cotton cultivation in the Deep South at the turn of the 19th century made slavery more widespread, entrenched, and profitable than ever before. By the time of the Civil War, there were nearly 4 million enslaved African Americans in the United States. You can see this very rapid demographic and geographic transformation of this institution across the first six decades of the 19th century. And historians who've done economic research on this have really noted the astounding economic importance of slavery to the American capitalist system. Nearly $3 billion invested in slaveholding in the decades before the Civil War. This is more than railroads and other industries combined, and is only second to the amount of money invested in farms in the United States. It's an enormous source of wealth for the United States. The rise of slavery as a cornerstone of the U.S. economy emerged hand in hand with the brutal over-policing of black communities that remains very much a part of our lives today. One of the fundamental tensions in the system of slavery is that while enslaved people were legally defined as property, they were, of course, human beings with minds, hearts, and bodies who could act upon their own will, especially their own will not to be enslaved. To ensure that enslaved people would not revolt or run away, Southern slave owners depended on the vigilance of every white male member of the community, rich and poor, slaveholding and non-slaveholding, to police and surveil every movement, every activity of any black person that threatened to undermine slaveholders' authority. This policing and surveillance was most evident in slave patrols, essentially gangs of white men who crisscrossed the southern plantation countryside looking for any black person who couldn't account for themselves, who was out on the roads alone, but also in informal kinds of policing. Essentially, it was the right and, in fact, the responsibility, the obligation of any white citizen to apprehend or at the very least report some person of color who they happen to see out on the streets, out of the supervision of a white person who they believed might be threatened with a pro-slavery regime. Now, while poor and non-slaveholding men often resented having to take part in this system, they also received status and power, and most important in the slave society, a sense of mastery from the authority to stop, interrogate, harass, and apprehend any black person. Along with arbitrary violence, the relentless policing of black communities was the glue that held together both slavery and white supremacy in this era. Of course, conversely, this meant that if you are any African-American person, man, woman, child, free, enslaved, you could be stopped whenever you were on the road or in some place not directly under the supervision of a white person and be asked to show your papers, right? Either to show a pass that said that you were had the permission of your master to be on the roads, or your free papers issued by a state court indicating that you were in fact a free person and not a slave, because of course the presumption is if you are a black person acting independently, you are potentially a runaway slave until you prove otherwise. the equivalent today with show your ID, right? So what does this all have to do with Baltimore? Let's take it back to that. Baltimore's position on the border between slavery and freedom, a place where slavery was on the decline, a place where thousands of newly freed people of color were exercising some new liberties, threatened to disrupt the surveillance and policing systems that customarily supported slavery throughout the South. Free and enslaved Black Baltimoreans regularly undermined the pro-slavery police regime. Baltimore's 3,000 enslaved people regularly mingled with, socialized with, and even intermarried with its very large free Black population. Baltimore's free Black community harbored and helped runaway slaves from all over the South, and became an important node in the so-called Underground Railroad network by which escaped slaves ran north to the free states. So it was kind of in part, I think you could say, to try better to regulate this intermingling of freed and enslaved people, intermingling that threatened the very institution of slavery, that Baltimore created that modern police force. In 1853, when the Maryland State Legislature first created the Baltimore Police, it tellingly charged police officers with enforcing municipal laws, quote, regarding slaves and free Negroes, end quote. Throughout the 1850s, capturing fugitive slaves in free Black neighborhoods was a major task of this new police force. Policing in a city like Baltimore on the fluid borderland between slavery and freedom was fundamentally rooted in the imperative of preserving white supremacy and suppressing African American activity perceived to be subverting white authority. And this remained so after even emancipation, when newly freed Black Americans sought to assert new constitutional rights after the death of slavery. So just a word in conclusion, the history of policing and slavery in the United States go hand in hand together. They serve as an important reminder that part of the reason that these problems of police brutality and racial inequality can seem so intractable to us, so calcified in American institutions and societies, is because these problems are rooted in centuries of systematic oppression. Dismantling them, I firmly believe, really requires us to grapple with the nation's painful history of slavery, a task that, frankly, many white Americans have yet to take on in a meaningful way. So I'm going to stop it there, and I'm going to hand it over to my colleague, Marisa